Okay, apologize for that. Then next we'll go to Ace Hoffman, and third to Robert Gould. So, Mr. Kamps, please.
Thank you. Good day, everyone. My name is Kevin Kamps, radioactive waste specialist at Beyond Nuclear. And my first question is, I have a large number of questions, so is there some way that I can submit those to be answered? I don't understand really the proper way to do that, because I don't have time in this 5 minutes to...
Yes, this is Kevin Witt. You can email me.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
And that's kevin.witt with two T's at nrc.gov.
So I'll just get as far as I can on my list. It was said, I believe, in the introductory remarks by the NRC that none of the pools have leaked. Actually, I have it right here in the notes. 20 Japanese spent fuel pools reported no leakage after both the 2007 and 2011 severe earthquakes. And I think the key word that's missing is the word yet. I think it's been communicated by several speakers today that there's ongoing problems at the Fukushima Daiichi site, perhaps most especially at Unit 4. So we're not out of the woods yet. And I did want to correct the record on a number of points. It was also said by Dr. Yule that an effective evacuation had taken place at Fukushima Daiichi. And there was an August 2011 New York Times article which quoted the mayor of Namai, which is a town 5 miles from Fukushima Daiichi, who, for lack of guidance from both the national and prefectural government, decided to evacuate his town's population further away from Fukushima Daiichi. And most ironically and unfortunately for those people, directly into the plume, because three separate federal ministries had withheld information from the public about the direction of the fallout from Fukushima. And most tragically, they were literally camped out under precipitation and probably got bad doses. They were drinking and cooking with water from surface streams, and the children were playing in this fallout. So the mayor actually referred to the people who withheld the data from him as murderers. That was his word. So I have to challenge that notion of an effective evacuation at Fukushima Daiichi. And to bring it closer to this context, when I attended the annual performance assessment at Kewaunee this past June, it appears that there may be a move on at Kewaunee to do away with the emergency planning zone now that that reactor is permanently shut down within a year or two, I believe. And questions were asked by local residents, how can that be? How can you do that when there's still irradiated fuel in the pool? And this very study was trotted out by the NRC staff in the room, even though this hadn't been published yet, made publicly available, that no, it's actually not a problem. There's a study that says it's not a problem. So it's okay that we do away with the emergency planning zones. So I've heard a number of times today an assumption by the NRC that evacuation will be smooth and successful, and that's how we can determine that cost-benefit analysis finds that we don't need to expedite transfer. So can someone address those inconsistencies for me?
Excuse me, this is Jennifer Yule. Somebody, Randy Sullivan from our Office of Nuclear Security and Incident Response.
Hi, Randy Sullivan. I'm an emergency preparedness specialist at NRC. Matter of fact, I've done emergency preparedness just about all of my career. Let's start with the last issue first. Kewaunee must apply for an exemption to reduce its emergency plan, and it is not reduced as we sit right now. So
yes, but the answer that was given in Carlton, Wisconsin this June was that within 12 to 24 months, a shutdown reactor could do away with its emergency planning zone. And I assume the reason that the question was asked and the answer is given was that that is under consideration at Kewaunee.
When they file their paperwork and it is adjudicated, that is a possibility. But that doesn't mean the whole emergency plan goes away. There will still be an emergency plan. The next, going backwards, if I'm remembering your questions right, regarding evacuations in the U.S., I take great exception to your comparison of our program to the Japanese program. I think there's significant differences in the way we handle evacuations. There's no federal ministry that issues evacuation orders in the U.S. That's done by local authorities who have proved that they're really quite competent in managing evacuations. We studied a couple hundred evacuations nationwide in this country. They were all successful. I can point to one evacuation in 15 years that was not successful. All the others saved lives. The local authorities are pretty good at this. And if I might say with all due respect, without a whole lot of guidance from Washington, I think if you talk to the local authorities as to whether they can evacuate their county or not, should it be necessary, I think you'll get an illuminating answer. I can't remember what you said before that. If there's something I can help you with, I'd be happy to.
Okay. Well, I will take exception to exception. I think that one exception that you probably cited was Katrina, which I think has a lot of lessons for the NRC to learn. Ironically enough, there was a emergency preparedness conference taking place at NRC as Katrina broke, and I think the 1,000 people or more who died in New Orleans would probably take exception.
Actually, it was not Katrina, Randy Sullivan again, if I can add. The congressional study of Hurricane Katrina determined that the evacuation itself was successful. Everybody who wanted to evacuate, whether they had money or not, could evacuate. The problem was not encouraging the people to evacuate and not to have a plan to deal with them when they don't. Hurricane Rita, some 6 weeks later, actually was a the one evacuation we've studied that actually killed people.
Yeah, I think, as I said, a lot of people died in New Orleans, but, you know, it wasn't me who brought up this issue. It was the NRC, Dr. Yule, who said that the evacuation at Fukushima Daiichi was effective, and that's what I was referring to. It was not effective for one example, the town of Namai. So, another point that was raised by the previous public member, Lou Zeller, was that U.S. Senator Ed Markey just yesterday pointed out the irony to Chairwoman McFarland that she joined several people who were in the room today, including Robert Alvarez and Ed Lyman, Gordon Thompson, who was on the phone, in a peer-reviewed study, that actually saw great cost-benefit advantage to expediting the transfer of irradiated nuclear fuel out of pools into dry cask storage. So I would just underline that point. I just wanted to touch on another accident scenario that was not looked at apparently in this study, and that's heavy load drops. There have been some near misses around the country at Palisades in 2005, at Prairie Island in the mid-1990s. So with these optimistic assumptions that the pool will completely drain of its water, it seems like there are some worst case scenarios that, for one, Dr. Thompson has pointed out, where there's a partial drain. And we, of course, as one of the 24 groups represented by Dr. Thompson and by Diane Curran in that coalition, endorse that concern that there could be worst case scenarios than what you've looked at. So could you address that?
Sorry, this is Steve Jones in the Office of Nuclear Reactor Regulation. I guess from a heavy loads perspective, first of all, there's a large fraction of the fleet has separate cask loading areas that are separated from the spent fuel pool, and the cranes are restricted from operation over those pools. So for those facilities, we don't expect any impact from heavy load drops. The for the remaining pools, there's some that are founded on bedrock and others that have very thick floors on the order of 4 or more feet thick that may be susceptible to cracking in the event of a load drop from some heights, but we don't have detailed evaluations of those. But regardless of that, we do expect that if there was a problem with a cast drop, it would largely be a leak at the bottom of the pool, not a leak somewhere that would cause a partial drain condition.
Jennifer Yule from NRI can add to that too. In our regulatory analysis, although the cast off was not explicitly modeled in the spent fuel pool study, in Appendix D to the spent fuel pool study, we do consider the looking at new Reg 1738, which was a previous study that was done. We took the initiating event frequency from CASCOP, and that was factored into our regulatory analysis. So if you are interested, you can take a look there. There's a little bit more information.
Yeah, the McFarland et al. Study from 2003 also referred to that as a citation, the significance of a heavy load drop. I wanted to touch on Fukushima Daiichi again. It's interesting to hear what the NRC has had to say today, because there was a point in time when the chairman, Greg Yasko, the NRC's representative on the ground in Japan, Chuck Casto at the time, with the best information they had available, were making precautionary assumptions that unit number 4's pool had lost water, that there could be a pool fire underway. And that contributed, perhaps in large part, to a decision to evacuate Americans 50 miles away from Fukushima Daiichi. And also U.S. Advice to Japan, I guess you could say, probably contributed to Japanese decisions to use helicopter water drops as many as 5 days after the initiation of the catastrophe at Fukushima Daiichi, the use of concrete pumping trucks to get water into the pools. So today it's been expressed as there were no problems with the pools. There was a period of time when the NRC was quite concerned that there were catastrophic problems with the pools. So it seems like catastrophic problems with pools, that is fires releasing catastrophic amounts of hazardous radioactivity, is within the realm of possibility and should be defended against. But you wouldn't know that listening to what NRC has to say today, as compared to, let's say, the first week of the Fukushima Daiichi catastrophe, when it was believed that there was a fire underway.
Yes, this is Jennifer Yeo from NR. Yes, a number of us were in the Incident Response Center here during and after the Fukushima event. Again, we talked earlier about the rationale for, there was the hydrogen explosion, and that we thought, well, we didn't at that time understand that the building, that the hydrogen was migrating from the Unit 3 reactor building. So with the hydrogen explosion, we didn't quite understand what was happening there. So to take a conservative measure, when the Japanese said, do you think it's a zirconium fire? Yeah. We said, well, we don't know. We weren't getting a lot of information. And so there was a suggestion, if you have water available, put it in. Now, it turned out that that wasn't the case, but we felt that was conservative at the time. And it really was highlighted to us the importance of situational awareness in a reactor accident scenario. And as a result, post-Fukushima, we've required licensees to put in spent fuel pool level instrumentation, so that, again, under such a scenario, we would the operators would be able to better understand the levels in the pool to then hopefully not distract them. Although we don't believe that such a drain down is probable, but because of the lessons learned that it was distracting, that we took that action.
And I commend the NRC for taking conservative actions like that. I would point out that one of the nearest misses we've had with a pool drain down was a frozen pipe at Dresden Unit 1. So I just find it astounding that some half century after these reactors were designed, that there's still no instrumentation on the pools to know where the water's at. The final point I'll make is regarding terrorism and security issues. With mass shootings on U.S. Navy bases, U.S. Army bases, on the other side of the coin, a nonviolent action at the Oak Ridge weapons-grade uranium depot, it's pretty clear that the highest security zones in this country are vulnerable to infiltration. And the example I'll give for a nuclear power plant is Palisades in Michigan, where the head of security, long story short, was a complete fraud who had fabricated his security clearances, had fabricated his credentials to hold that position, and fortunately was not a threat, although his behavior would have indicated that he was a threat because he bragged about his violent career, I guess you could say, which seemed to have gotten him the job. So that wasn't the only plant he worked at. He worked at Seabrook as well, and it was Esquire magazine that broke this story in May of 2007. So it seems to me that an intentional insider attack on a high-level radioactive waste storage pool may be the worst-case scenario, and I wonder why that hasn't been considered in this study.
My name's Ralph Way. I'm Senior Technical Advisor for Security in the Office of Nuclear Security and Incident Response. We have looked at the insider, and that look has intensified as a result of recent incidents as well. We have a behavioral observation program and a number of other programs put in place to ensure that individuals are both screened and they're monitored while they're on site.
So, referring back to my example again, William Clark at Palisades, Chief of Security, apparently passed all of NRC's and Consumers Energy's and Entergy Nuclear's screening procedures. So how did he get his job if NRC has these screening procedures in place?
Well, we put the screening procedures in place. He goes through a background check, and there are a number of other agencies that are involved. But even once an individual is on site and job, there's a behavioral observation program and other programs in place to monitor an individual's activities as he goes forward. That's how he was detected.
What I find ironic, and I encourage you to read the Esquire magazine article, May of 2007, if an Esquire reporter can detect aberrant behavior with a chief of security at a U.S. nuclear power station, then I don't understand how the NRC missed that. And, you know, just citing the Navy Yard shootings 2 days ago, that individual had a security clearance. He also had a pass. That's how he got in. So if we can't secure the weapons-grade uranium storage depot in the United States, I take NRC's assurances with a grain of salt about security at these.
Well, I'll say one additional point. In addition to the behavioral observation program, there are a number of other physical barriers that are put in place to protect plants and plant material from sabotage.
Yep. The examples I've given have shown that other agencies of the federal government have failed in those regards. Thank you.